Janos Toth. He's the principal engineer and CTO of at FRP Transmission Innovations, and he's responsible for new products in the transmission and distribution industry. He has a PhD from the University of Arizona and the NASA Space Engineering Research Center, and he was previously an independent consultant and former senior specialist at BC Hydro and the research development project manager for the British Columbia Transmission Corporation. So please help me welcome Janos Toth.
Thank you.
We had a bit of a discussion what to do, what to present. So finally, actually, this is like a watered down version of the really, I had initially about 100 slides. So I think each topic would deserve almost a presentation on its own. So I'd like to, as a quick outline, you know, I'd like to mention some of the challenges utilities, electrical utilities generally have, and also some opportunities and opportunities for technology improvement, incremental or potentially maybe better one. And also I'd like to mention some innovative solutions which are already have in place in British Columbia. So when we say all this, well, pessimist, optimist, you know, glass is half full or half empty, I'm more of an engineer and say, well, the glass is twice as large as it should be. So, so about the electrical system, we all know actually many of us worked in this area. Actually, the National Academy of Engineering named it as the greatest engineering achievement of the 20th century. And the electrical grid is the largest industrial investment in the history of mankind. Actually, some people also stated that the North American electrical system is the biggest and most complex machine humankind ever built. And it evolved gradually
together, and during about 110 years, it ended up what it is now with all the challenges
and initial, well, outcomes actually predicted. A bit of a historical background, you know all the stories about when it started, but what I really like to say that the majority of the system in North America, particularly US, Canada, was built in the 60s and 80s. And then after the 90s, there wasn't much transmission expansion happened due to many different reasons. And in 1992, the electrical deregulation began in the US, and it had significant impact on the overall business, both technical and other. And then 9/11 came, and the 9/11 impact was actually quite substantial. I will elaborate a bit further, but particularly in the security, the need for having electricity for all parts of life, and also the demand for security at any cost. So many US utilities, for example, the security department is much larger than the engineering and the asset management department combined. And it led to such events like there was one utility out of concern of biohazard or maybe some sort of pandemic approach, some terrorist activities, they vaccinated and implemented biohazard containment for all their employees and their families, and we are talking about 10,000 employees. So you can imagine the money allocated for this, and this is still maintained. So I'd like to just mention some of the major challenges. Well, definitely workforce demographics. There is a real definite aging workforce. Also, the system is aging as well. As mentioned, you know, the most of the system was built in 60s, 70s. So when you planned 50 years of book life, we are at the end of the book life of the system in many aspects, many transmission lines. Then the regulatory and business environment changed drastically, and the technical condition of the system didn't improve either. There are financial constraints addressing all the system needs, and also this led to somewhat to the asset management approach, which tried to address all those issues together. Let's just start with the workforce. Overall in North America, recent less cutting actually in the utility industry have wiped out work training programs and gutted the ranks of experienced linemen. We also most of the time think about all the people who are managing, designing and putting together the system, but we many times forget about the linemen who actually maintain it, and just training one lineman takes about 5 years, and become a journeyman, an experienced journeyman, you can let the person work freely on a live energized line. It takes 10 years. So when you lay off, or some people leave a job, this is how the knowledge actually left the company. And also the deregulation in the US led to that utilities reduced their line staff 25-30%. So we have very shortage of linemen. Basically, it's like having your car mechanics, no car mechanics anymore. You can have the fanciest car, most technologically developed, the transportation. If nobody is maintaining it well, it is worth what it is used for. If you see the electrical workforce demographics, roughly about 50% of the people are eligible for retirement in 1 or 2 years. So, and then many who already not retired, they are very close to retirement. And as I mentioned, it's difficult to train and then gain experienced workforce in place when it's needed. The average line, actually the average age of a lineman now is 48 years. I mean average. You see very few young guys actually coming in. There are training programs, but many are actually quite old. Sorry for not having a very high resolution demographics chart. That was the best that I could find. This shows in the horizontal axis actually the age of the workforce, and the vertical axis actually the experience. And if you see quite well, in the middle there is a large gap. This is from the 1990s until the 20 years. There was no hiring, no training, no building. And first of all, there is an age gap in the utility sector. The other is the most worrisome is actually the knowledge gap, because there is no continuity passing down the knowledge, and really important factors which cannot be documented. You cannot document certain system knowledge, familiarity with many of the many aspects of the job. You cannot simply just write it down on paper. And this is a major, major issue. And if you see, and many of the people actually, like 41, 44 years of experience, they are still working. If you started in your early 20s, I mean, how old is the workforce now? And then I was very surprised to see actually that one of the US utilities, there was an engineer who hasn't retired and he was 73 and he came in on a walker. I mean, that was actually a bit of an eye-opener. So we have to be careful actually how we see. And beside that, the engineering programs, the training programs, power engineering and all the other engineering supporting the power system is really gutted out. If you see other countries, University of Peking, electrical engineering, power engineering department has more faculty and graduate students than the entire all departments in the US and Canada in power engineering combined. And if you see that actually tells you quite a bit about future employment, and that's why you see certain people actually in certain industries, the age group and also the knowledge is very different. So what is the issues with the aging workforce? First of all, is lost knowledge. Well, you can document some knowledge, but you cannot do it all. Also, the age gap accelerates the problem. No one with the sufficient experience to pass the knowledge to. If you have an old guy and then the next one in line is 25 years behind, you simply don't have the capability to learn. Not just I'm talking about, you know, using certain programs, but simply the whole knowledge what you accumulate during your lifetime. Also, the mindset of the aged workforce, very conservative, difficult to try new things. For example, I heard it many times, no change until I retired. But if you have this big gap for the next 10, 15 years and you wait for the retirement because you need to do well and you need to do new things. Training is well at all level behind demand, so something has to be done. And also, this is a very so-called old environment. I worked with, during my career, about 20, 25 COPE students for various universities, and only a fraction of them ended up at the utility sector, and they told me one of the reasons, because they worked other areas, and much more fun to work in a gaming industry, a new startup companies. The whole culture when you walk in, even the relaxed atmosphere, and then less formality or a buffet in the workplace, so the whole culture is different. And they say, well, if we can work, why should we work in a less than favorable environment for us? So that's also an issue which could be addressed or should be addressed at some point. Regulation, you know, market relies on the transmission system definitely, and then results more scrutiny, progress is increasing, demand for all kinds of transparency, and that comes with all kinds of project management issues, documentation, quite a bit of bureaucracy. And in the US, it's very significant about the security home. You know, the Homeland Security actually put together all these demands for the electrical system, how you protect it, what to protect, what you have to maintain, how you protect it. And then when you maintain that, you have to maintain that protection as well. It did a tremendous amount of cost in the US. In Canada, actually, we feel it less. Only the interconnectivity and also the FERC requirements, which are filtering to us. Reliability, well, this came, you know, widespread outages bring increased scrutiny and standards. If you see that actually in the statistics, the US general outage time is about 10 times higher than the German outage time. And that tells you something, which is very significant. Also, competition, open access to electricity market, that led to all kinds of fast, you know, trading and other stuff. And also, having, you know, money matters the most. In the US, there are some merchant transmission line companies. They purchase 750 kV lines, run them for a couple of years. They don't do any maintenance on them. And somebody has to catch up in the next round, and somebody has to pay for it. Environmental mandate, you know, renewable energy, all this other stuff. We talked about quite a bit that it has to be done some different ways. Just to get home, a little bit about the cost considerations. As an engineer, I really like the idea of old-timers taught me, you know, if you cannot do it on a back on an envelope or you cannot do it with a slide rule, then it is really too complicated. So if you see roughly the cost of maintaining the system, the book value is about $6 billion for the transmission grid in BC. And I'm just talking about transmission lines. About 18,000 kilometers of those lines. If you see the cost what we have in the northwest transmission line, if you have to build it now from scratch, just the lines would cost you right away $60 billion. And we didn't talk about substations, which would be another $40 billion. If you need appropriate generation to build, it would be roughly 10 times the transmission cost. So we can do it on the back of an envelope. How much money actually is supposed to be spent if you want to even just up to this level where we are now? So it's an enormous cost. And then if the full electrification of the BC transit system happens, we need 2.5 times the power and transmission what we have now. Where is the money? How can we address that? Anyway, it's just more of an open question at the moment. The financial deficit of the system is quite enormous. I mean, we need by 2020 about $1.5 to $2 trillion just in US and Canada to be invested. And alone the T&D would be like 880 billions and transmission about 300 billions. Alone, out of this $1.5 to $2 trillion, the need for Canada, just the Canadian side, is about $300 billion. And we simply don't have that money. I don't think we can find the money to maintain the original accepted level of the transmission grid, as we hoped for 50 years ago. So that came the asset management approach. Well, if there is no enough resources, money, workforce, materials, well, we still have to maintain the system. And then after the system actually over its so-called book life, we still have to keep it running forever because this is the expectation. You don't have alternatives. And without spending large sum of money, so you have to do something, and the industrial asset management seemed to be an approach which actually provided some relief. So expectations, increase resource productivity, and this means all resources, meet regulations, standards, reporting requirement. In the process, you have to be cost-effective. And again, keep everything going, running forever. And where it is really challenging, for example, where you can make some short-time decisions. For example, I'm not going to paint that tower. It's a little bit rusty, fine. It doesn't impact my immediate reliability. But if you keep doing it for years and years, after a while, that tower will fall. And that, actually, if you see how many towers you have to paint, for example, in BC, you have 20,000 towers. Every 20 years you have to paint at least once, divided by how many thousands you need, $20,000 each tower to paint, you have the money right away, and we don't have that money being spent at the moment. Some of the consequences of asset management, large-scale outsourcing almost every activity. And then the really scary part is that the old model where you have engineering departments within utilities, they're being outsourced, and those engineering activities are further outsourced to overseas. So when you have any kind of activity, engineering work done, you don't know whether it was done in the Philippines or some other parts of the world. and then question what kind of knowledge, what knowledge background actually you have. A good example, there was a major engineering company in town, when they got a contract from the local utility, their office was 5 people. Within 6 months, they grew the group up to 170 or so. And guess how many experienced people you would have among them? Very few. And they still have to do the work. Also, big issue was with the asset management, that the separation happened between the decision-making, technical knowledge and responsibilities. The technical knowledge and responsibilities was still left with the technical people, but the decision-making was taken away from them, and that created a bit of a discord. Also, the varying level of reliability. Well, you say, okay, you have certain requirements where you have to maintain the system, but that level of reliability has to be defined somebody, and then most of the time it's just somebody say, okay, we will take that risk. So this is actually some aspects becoming more of a gambling than risk-taking, because when you take risk, you exactly know what you are doing, and you step into it eyes open. Okay. Some of the meeting challenge I like to mention. Opportunities, one of those, knowledge management, material science, and I also like to mention some new technologies. Just some eye-opener, you know, technical development, what we had in the 50s and now in the phone, TV, typewriter, whatever industry, I mean that. And then if you go to the utility sector, not much change if you look around. And then one area is a knowledge management, which is tremendously, I think, unutilized portion. It could be developed, like hiring oral historians and people before they retire, capture the knowledge. Actually, some utilities do that. It's quite good. New other areas of material science, developing new materials for various purposes, and then this actually leads to like a rational material design. This is a new area where at the borderline of regular chemistry and regular material science in the nano range, where you can engineer materials for the specific purpose, and then this leads to new alloys, new materials, which are definitely needed. I'd like to mention some local possibilities. This is actually from SFU Cyber. There is a professor who is doing a fantastic job. She developed a system. Actually, it's a combination of solar cell, energy storage, and also power transmission. And then this is being made with an inkjet printer-like machinery, inexpensive, very simple to use, very simple to install. And the cost, actually, I think you will hear more about this. This is very, really great. Another one, this is a good example, grew out from BCTC originally, needed demand for a specific purpose of using material, and this grew out to a company, a startup company, which is world leader in new materials, transmission line and distribution line development structures for the utility sector. And this is actually a photo of installed in BC Hydro System, the world first fully composite H-frame structure, which is really in many aspects is first. It created quite a bit of buzz in the industry. Also, other opportunities in R&D, developing and implementing sensors for all kinds of applications. When you have a chance to download this presentation, you can see there are other business opportunities. Also, implementing robotics, you know, you have to have this all system maintained. You need to know the conditions, so this is leading to unmanned aerial vehicles. Certain robotics, for example, generation robotics, it's a really good example of what Hydro-Quebec IREC did. They have a very good robotics program, turbine surface finishing, all this stuff, tremendously beneficial for the industry. Distribution robots, they build distribution poles and cross arms and also maintain them, live line, using robotics system. It's quite interesting, actually, they like it very much. And the last item I'd like to mention, this is very closely connected to BC, the line scout technology, which was developed by Hydro-Quebec, and significantly, it was a significant collaboration between BC Transmission and later a little bit of BC Hydro in implementing transmission line inspection and minor repair robotics in transmission lines. And this actually led that the last act of BCTC, just before 2 weeks before it was merged back to BC Hydro, this technology implementation and innovation won the Edison Award from the Edison Electric Institute, just recognizing outstanding leadership and innovation. So those are actually within BC, and the BC and Vancouver has the potential to be a real nice knowledge hub, technology hub for utility industry. And I think we should grab that opportunity, because old industry with new technologies can address many things. And I think the future could be much more attractive to young people than it seems right now. Thank you.